the Philippines.
And we are ANC.
Good morning, I'm Mike DeValio.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, a bloodbath in Afghanistan. Suicide bombers strike the crowded gates of Kabul's airport, killing dozens of American service members and Afghan civilians.
U.S. President Joe Biden vows retaliation against Islamic State, which has claimed responsibility for the attack in Kabul.
Several regions across the Philippines are classified as high risk for COVID-19 amid rising infections and hospitalizations.
And President Rodrigo Duterte says he will now allow gambling in Boracay.
Thank you for joining us. We begin in Afghanistan, where dozens of people, including U.S. troops, have been killed following the bombing of Kabul's airport. The blast brings to a halt the airlift of tens of thousands of Afghans desperate to flee the country ever since the Taliban took over. The Pentagon says there were at least two explosions, one of which appeared to be a suicide bombing. 12 U.S. service members were among the casualties, while video images uploaded by Afghan journalists showed dozens of bodies of locals. According to the Taliban, 52 were wounded, though that number could be higher. Islamic State has claimed responsibility for the attack. The U.S. and its allies earlier urged Afghans to leave the airport because of a threat by Islamist militants. But a Western diplomat says the areas outside the airport gates were still crowded despite the warnings.
U.S. President Joe Biden vows to hunt down those behind the twin explosions at the Kabul airport. Biden says he has ordered commanders to take the maximum steps necessary to protect U.S. forces in Kabul and has asked the Pentagon to develop plans to strike back at the Islamic State.
We will not forget. We will hunt you down and make you pay. I will defend our interests and our people with every measure at my command.
U.S. General Frank McKenzie, head of the U.S. Central Command, says the threat from Islamic State and other groups persists, but he asserts the evacuation mission is not going to stop. The U.S. has been racing to carry out the airlift before its military is set to fully withdraw from the country by August 31st.
The threat from ISIS is extremely real. We've been talking about this for several days. We saw it actually manifest itself here just in the last few hours with an actual attack. We believe it is their desire to continue those attacks, and we expect those attacks to continue. And we're doing everything we can to be prepared for those attacks. That includes reaching out to the Taliban, who are actually providing the outer security cordon around the airfield, to make sure they know what we expect them to do to protect us. And we will continue to coordinate with them as they go forward.
ISIS-K, the Islamic State affiliate, which claimed responsibility for the attack, is a sworn enemy of the Taliban.
United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres denounces the deadly attack on Kabul's airport. Guterres says he is following the situation with grave concern. He adds the incident underscores the volatility of Afghanistan, but also strengthens their resolve to continue to deliver urgent assistance to the Afghan people.
Well, I'd like to express in the strongest possible way my total condemnation about the horrific terrorist attack in Kabul, to send my condolences to the families of all those that perished, Afghans, and those that were helping there, the Afghans, and died serving the lives of others.
And several areas across the Philippines are classified as high risk for COVID-19 amid rising infections and hospitalizations. The steepest climb in cases is being reported in the National Capital Region, Region 4A, and the rest of Luzon. They are also seeing high hospital bed occupancy and intensive care unit utilization rates. The health department earlier confirmed there is community transmission of the Delta variant in NCR and Region 4A, because cases can no longer be linked to one another. but it still can't say if the highly contagious strain is already the dominant variant in the country.
The reason why there's caution at our end, kung bakit ayaw namin magsabi na predominant ang Delta, predominant na yung VOC sa ating sample run. The sampling methodology that we employ is very biased towards detecting the VOC. Inuuna natin at pinaprioritize natin masama yung mga lugar na may pagtaas ng kaso.
Apart from a limited genome sequencing capacity, the government admits its active case finding and contact tracing programs still need to be improved.
Sa ngayon po, medyo hindi maganda yung ating statistika dahil naabot po ng 12 araw bago po ma-isolate ang isang nakumpirmado ng COVID-19 positive. Gusto natin pa-clean ito ng 6 na araw, kaya po tayo nagsisipag.
Check namin lagi yung mga...
The Philippines logged 16,313 new COVID cases Thursday, bringing the nationwide tally to 1,899,000. The ABS-CBN data analytics team projects the country will hit 1.9 million mark today. Active infections stand at nearly 132,000, the highest since April 19. 236 more deaths were also reported, as well as over 9,000 recoveries.
More health workers in the Philippines are set to receive allowances and benefits. That's according to Health Chief Francisco Duque III. He says the health department will submit over 17,600 additional names of health workers eligible to get their special risk allowance. That's on top of the 20,000 frontliners already submitted to the budget department under the 311 million peso fund.
Kasalukuyan din, Mr. President, ay nakikipag-ugnayan ng DOH sa mga LGUs at mga private hospitals upang makalap ang dagdag na bilang ng mga health workers na nararapat pang makatanggap ng special risk allowance.
But health worker groups are still threatening to strike, saying the government still owes them other benefits like hazard pay, as well as meals, accommodation, and transportation. The Alliance of Health Workers is giving government until Friday to hand over these benefits.
Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte tells the public not to believe graft investigations as he defended his cabinet from corruption allegations. He says nothing comes out from these probes. Both houses of Congress are currently looking into the health department's supposed mismanagement of its multi-billion peso pandemic response budget after being flagged by state auditors.
Pakinggan mo ng mga ibang senador dyan, meron talaga masabi. After an investigation, 1 or 2 or 3 days your hearing, wala na. Walang rekomendasyon, walang dinemanda, walang napriso. Puro postura lang, question.
Duterte also vowed to audit the whole government if he wins as vice president in the 2022 elections. Duterte, who has been criticizing the Commission on Audit since it released its findings on the health department, said the COA itself should be audited.
I will do that if I become vice president. Ako na lang rin ang mag-audit sa lahat ng gobyerno. Lahat. Pati yung akin. Mag-umpisa ako sa akin.
The country's finance chief believes all Filipinos can be vaccinated against COVID-19 by early next year. Secretary Carlos Dominguez says government has secured nearly 200 million doses, which he says is enough to inoculate the entire population. The Philippines has so far received about 15 million of these jabs. Some 100 million more shots are expected to arrive from October to December.
Actually, we are expecting roughly 50 million doses a month from September to December. If that happens, siguro by January, we should have been able to inoculate everyone ho. Wala ho tayong problema sa pera. May financing na lahat yan. At we don't have to worry about any about money here. We have already all the money ready to be paid for these doses.
13.3 million Filipinos have been fully vaccinated against the coronavirus, while 18 million have received their first dose.
The Philippine Drug Regulator anticipates commercial availability of COVID vaccines in the country by early next year. Food and Drug Administration Chief Eric Domingo expects Pfizer to seek a product registration certificate for its COVID vaccine in the Philippines. U.S. regulators recently granted full approval for Pfizer's vaccine. Domingo believes other manufacturers may follow suit in the last quarter of the year. He agrees with Presidential Advisor Joey Concepcion that prices of COVID jabs may increase once they're given full approval.
Very likely yan. Dahil ngayon, syempre pinapangako ng mga companies na nagbebenta sila nito sa mga gobyerno ng walang tubo, di ba? Bilang tulong sa worldwide drive natin against COVID-19. Pero syempre kapag ito ay naging marketing, may marketing authorization na, magkakaroon na ng pagbabago.
And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, the Commission on Elections details its preparations for next year's national polls.
And President Rodrigo Duterte says he will now allow gambling in Boracay. Listen more when the rundown returns. Stay tuned.
We visit two watersheds in the province of Aurora, the Amro River Protected Landscape and the Talaytay Protected Landscape. The rivers are the life.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Welcome back to The Rundown. The headlines across the web, Inquirer's banner story online, the Kabul bombing that left dozens dead, Philippine Star's top story that the ICT asked to explain why its Stay Safe app had little to no impact in COVID-19 tracing efforts, Manila Bulletin's headline, Palace spokesperson Harry Roque calling on the public to let the Dutetes settle their political rift in private. Topping GMA News' website, President Duterte asked the Commission on Audit for more elbow room amid the pandemic. And the Kabul blast also topping CNN Philippines' website.
The Philippines' two potential administration bets for president deny having any rift. Senator Bongo and Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte claim all is well between them. As the mayor's father, President Duterte, firms up his decision to run for vice president. More from Pia Lucheres.
After months of uncertainty, President Duterte says he now has clear political plans for 2022.
As of 5:46 kahapon po ng hapon, ito po ang huling mensahe ng presidente tungkol sa issue ng politika. Things are clear now. I will run as vice president.
Duterte earlier confirmed that he will be running for vice president, but he is willing to drop his plans if his daughter, Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio, decides to run for president next year. Roque says the elder Duterte is convinced Mayor Sara will not pursue the presidency based on her recent statement.
The president's stand remains. Delicadeza dictates that only one Duterte will run. So since only one Duterte will run, and in his perception, the Mayor Sara will not run, then he can run for vice president.
On Wednesday, the Davao mayor told her father and Senator Bongo to leave her out of their political decisions and just own up to their plans. Malacanang meanwhile tells the public to let father and daughter settle the matter between themselves. Mayor Sara also denied reports of a supposed rift with his father's longtime aide and presumed presidential running mate Senator Bongo. The younger Duterte insists that she's not her father's keeper and that she does not hold any grudge against Go. The senator also says all is well between him and Mayor Sara.
Nakakausap naman kami ni Mayor Sara, wala kaming issue sa isa't isa.
Go maintains he will support whatever decision the Dutetes make.
Kung ano ang usapan nilang magtatay, nasa kanila na po yun. Pero tulad ng sinabi ko noon, anuman ang magiging desisyon nila, susuportahan ko.
The senator has repeatedly insisted he's not interested to run for president, though he admits he will support a candidate who will continue the legacy of the Duterte administration. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
A viable presidential candidate for 2022. That's how one political analyst described Davao Mayor and presidential daughter Sara Duterte Carpio. But Professor Francisco Magno of the De La Salle University believes Duterte Carpio's possible campaign won't be a walk in the park. He also sees Senator Manny Pacquiao's potential presidential run affecting the mayor's chances of winning.
People tend to make choices on the basis of who they know. It's not really about making choices on the basis of what they want the Philippines to be in terms of changes in programs, policies that will lead to a better quality of life, a better environment, a better society. Right now, it's a very open race. If Pacquiao runs, it will definitely place a large dent on the candidacy of Mayor Sara Duterte. The Pacquiao vote will really cut across the Mindanao vote, and that would be a very significant factor in these coming elections.
As the Commission on Elections gears up for the 2022 elections, an important aspect of the preparations is how to ensure the automated election system is secure. There are two parallel ways by which the poll body is going about this. First, there's an international certification entity that checks the software and hardware of the automated election system. Then there's the local source code review, where qualified stakeholders are invited to examine the source code that will be used for the polls. A source code refers to human-readable instructions that define what the computer equipment will do. The COMELEC has opened the application period for certain qualified groups to participate in the process until September 10. To know where exactly is the COMELEC in terms of its technical preparations, We sat down with COMELEC Commissioner Marlon Casquejo at the COMELEC's main office in Intramuros on Wednesday. Watch this. What is the status in terms of choosing your international certification entity?
Well, for now, we are still in the process of the bidding. And by this Friday, there will be an opening of bids. And we hope that this will be a smooth sailing bidding process because they still have to comply the GPPB rules. So in the event that the bidding process will be open this coming Friday, then that's the time we have our international certification entity.
How many actually bid it?
Well, initially we have 3 bidders, but then again, after the bid process, the bid procedure, only one remain, which is the previous ICE certification in the last 2019 elections.
So that's Pro-VNV?
Yes, that's Pro-VNV.
The other aspect is the local source code review. Now, when we talk about the source code, Public Issue associates it with the 2016 presidential polls where one of the candidates, one group, claimed that the source code was supposedly altered that led to the loss of their candidate. The COMELEC has already since debunked that claim. But tell us, just how important is the source code in terms of the entire automated election system and why should the public be interested in monitoring the review of the source code?
Well, first and foremost, this local source code review is mandated by the automation law. So that is very important to show to the public that the source code that we are going to use for the elections is not that's not contain any malicious lines or any invalid or whatsoever codes in there. So aside from the certification of the international certification entity, the public must know that the source code review is really what is being used for the 2022 for the elections.
How transparent will that review be? I understand you have certain criteria.
Well, number one is the reviewer must have knowledge about the software or the language that being used in the source code review. That is very basic. So how can one review when he does not know the language that we are using? Second, it must be designated by the political party or any party concerned or with regards to the qualifications. So we have in our application for the qualifications for that. So it is very important also that the local source code reviewer must be, let us say, appointed by a certain group for an IT interested parties. Kailangan, they have also a recommendation coming from the COMELEC Advisory Council and also the DICT. And not only that, we include also members of the COMELEC Advisory Council as well as the Joint Congressional Oversight Committee.
So where will the review be conducted? I understand that previously these were conducted at La Salle.
Well, considering the pandemic situation, we are looking for a bigger venue. So within this week, maybe we can have a venue for that. So we are looking for a venue that qualifies the requirement of the IATF.
How many people are you expecting to join the review?
Well, we're expecting 20 to 30 groups. 20 to 30 groups that will be joining the local source code review. Each group may designate 2, but on a given certain period, only one can attend the local source code review.
How long will this process last?
We will be looking into a 2-phase, which is for the first 3 months will be the guided review, and the second 3 months will be the unguided review. So that it will take us 6 months for the local source code review.
When you talk about guided review, does this mean there's some form of program or format that's being followed?
Yes, when we say guided review, there will be an engineers coming from the provider, and they will present what this function is all about, and then they will be discussing that one, and then the reviewers may give their comments. And for the unguided review, they have the leeway to look into whatever lines they want to review.
What source code will you be looking into? Are you going to look at the base source code or is it the final customized code?
In 2022 elections, we will be reviewing the final customized software. We will no longer use the base code for our first phase.
Which means that all the details of the candidates will already be there?
Yes, all the details of the EMS, the CCS and VCM and other components of the software, AES software.
Well, I ask in the context of calls for COMELEC to extend the voter registration period. Will this process be affected?
Yes, we are going to finalize our customized software this coming September 15. So if you are going to extend that one, then we have to extend also our customized software. And not only that, with our configuration of our system, it will start at December, on the first week of December. So a chance of a 1 week extension would mean a lot for the preparations of the commission.
What about the details of the source code? How will you protect the confidentiality?
So the software belongs now to the COMELEC because the COMELEC procure that such software, but we still need to protect the propriety of the software. So since it is owned by the COMELEC, so there will be a non-disclosure agreement that will be signed between the COMELEC as well as the local source code reviewer.
How strict will that non-disclosure agreement be?
We will try to make it lax insofar as the what will be allowed to be discussed outside the review room and what are not allowed to be discussed.
One of the controversial aspects in the previous elections is the shading of the circles in the ballots. Have you decided what percentage or threshold you will be using for next year's polls?
Well, for now, we still have yet to decide the threshold of the shading for the 2022 NLE. However, we are still using the same technology. We are still using the VCM from 2016, 2019, and now in 2022. So I guess the threshold will be similar to that of 2016 and 2019. Although we still use the same technology, the VCM technology, but we introduce a new software that will run to our VCM. So there are so many enhancements. For example, we have these digital signatures that will be used by our electoral board, which were not used in the previous elections. Second is the input of the names of the electoral board before opening of the polls. And most of the enhancement is on the EMS software in the configuration. But in the VCM, there are less enhancement, but it is more on something like a user-friendly software that the EB can easily operate the vote counting machine.
Have you identified who will be providing the software?
Following the GPPB rules, the Smartmatic won the bid.
How do you intend to explain to the public, some of whom might still be doubting the performance of Smartmatic in previous elections?
We would just like to clarify the public that Smartmatic is not the one who runs the election. They are just a provider. So they are just our technical provider for our system. So it is the COMELEC who runs the election. So all decisions, all being made by the COMELEC but not by the Smartmatic. So they are being called if there are problems with the software, but if their assistance is not needed, then they are just in the sideline.
Who are the other bidders?
Well, I can't remember the other bidders, but Smartmatic had the lowest calculated bid on that process. But I guess there were three bidders at that time.
Now, in the 2019 polls, there was an issue about the glitch, the 7-hour glitch in the transparency server. How do you intend to address that concern?
Well, what happened in 2019 in the transparency server, there were requests coming from the media entities that they will be allowed to bring laptops in order that the results coming from transparency server will automatically be pushed through their own laptops. So what we did is we create a software for that, just for pushing coming from the transparency server, going to each individual laptops. So the usual process is we do not allow outside laptops for the getting the results for the media entities as well as for the citizens' arm. So we require only a USB and just get a copy for the results. in the transparency server. So when the request of the media entities as well as the citizens are for that, so we allow them, so we create an app which is not part of the terms of reference of the one who won the bid for the transparency server. So that happens because of the influx of so many datas, because from 7 o'clock going up, there are so many results coming from the persons level. So it's like tagkaroon ng choke between that. But rest assured, during the conduct of the review of the PPCRV of the data logs, the transparency server continues receiving results. So there's nothing going on in the transparency server, only from the getting of the results. So what we did now in 2022, NLE, we include that in our terms of reference. So it will be part of the obligation or the responsibility of the winning bidder to provide the necessary app and tools and the laptop for the result going to the media entities. So 7-hour glitch will be no longer be a problem for the 2022 national and local elections.
Are we on time for the May 2022 polls given the pandemic?
Yes, we have no problem with the preparations. We started already our refurbishment of the VCM, and then we are still on track for the VCM refurbishment. We are in 27-28% VCM refurbished. In the software, we are already ready with the software for the release of the final software. So we have no problems with regards to the preparations for the 2022 NLE. What we are looking now is in the conduct of campaigning and on election day, because during pandemic, we really have to consider all those factors.
Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte changes his tune over gambling in Boracay. He says he will now allow a casino to be built in the popular tourist destination because government needs more funds.
Magsabi ka ba, si Duterte, bakit sabi mo ayaw mo ng sugal? Tapos ngayon, basi nyo sa Boracay, yung gambling house doon, ini-encourage mong buksan para sa tourist. Patawarin na po ninyo ako for the contradiction. Ngayon po, wala tayong pera. Kung saan man tayo makakuha ng pera, kukunin ko. Kung dyan sa gambling, so be it. Kung wala akong isang salita dyan, tama yan, wala akong isang salita dyan. Pero kailangan ko ng pera para patakbuhin ang gobyerno. Kasi marami akong gagastusan.
In 2018, Duterte ordered Boracay should be casino-free when the island reopened after its rehabilitation.
The Philippine economy is expected to return to its pre-pandemic levels between late 2022 and early 2023. That's according to Socioeconomic Planning Secretary Carl Chua, who previously said this would be achieved within next year. He cites the recent spikes in COVID-19 cases and the resulting lockdowns for the updated outlook. But he adds recovery prospects for 2021 remain promising.
The enablers of our recovery hinge on acceleration of the vaccination program, the continued safe reopening of the economy while adhering to the health protocols, and the full implementation of our recovery package, which includes the present 2021 budget, the CREATE law, and the FIS law.
The country's economic managers earlier slashed their growth targets for this year to 4-5%. From 6-7%. They still expect the economy to grow up to 9% in 2022.
Finance Secretary Carlos Dominguez expects government's borrowings to drop to 2.25 trillion pesos in 2022 from 3 trillion pesos this year. Dominguez says government's debt remains manageable thanks to prudent fiscal management. but he notes debt to GDP ratio is projected to slightly increase to 60% in 2022 from the programmed 59% in 2021. The country's debt has risen steadily during President Rodrigo Duterte's term, hitting over 11 trillion pesos at the end of June. That's nearly double from the 5.9 trillion peso debt at the start of Duterte's term in 2016. But government defends the loans, saying more money is needed to fund the Duterte administration's infrastructure program as well as its COVID-19 response.
A look now at the financial markets. Wall Street lost ground on Thursday, ending a streak of all-time closing highs. The sell-off was prompted by concerns over developments in Afghanistan, as well as fears of a potential shift in the U.S. Federal Reserve's policy ahead of the Jackson Hole symposium. All three major indices ended the session modestly lower, with the S&P 500 and the Nasdaq notching their first down day in six. Over in Europe, shares also closed lower, echoing global sentiment as U.S. policymakers gather for a closely watched monetary policy summit. And over here in Asia, stocks closed mostly in the red as South Korea became the first major economy to raise interest rates during the pandemic. The PSEI posting a flat finish at 68.20 despite the continued rally of telco stocks.
Now, here are some economic events we're monitoring this Friday. Australia will release its July retail sales data. Retail sales in Australia declined by 1.8% month on month in June, the first drop since February due to stay-at-home orders for multiple states and territories. France and Italy will come out with their consumer confidence figures for August, and the U.S. Federal Reserve will hold its annual Jackson Hole symposium virtually, this time bringing together central bankers around the world to discuss policy. Investors are particularly interested to know when the Fed will start winding down its bond buying program.
In other news, a Philippine court convicts a policeman who killed a woman and her son during an argument last year. Janelle Nuesca was found guilty on two counts of murder. He's been sentenced to serve up to 40 years in prison. Nuesca was also ordered to pay his victims' family over 950,000 pesos. Nuesca fatally shot Sonia and Frank Anthony Villorio in Tarlac last December. That incident was caught on video. The cold-blooded murders drew widespread condemnation and demands for reforms in the police force.
Gunmen in the Philippine city of Cebu kill a lawyer who handled the cases of activists. The victim was 64-year-old Rex Fernandez, a founding member of the National Union of People's Lawyers, or NUPL. NUPL President Edrio Lalia says Fernandez was silenced after castigating the current administration. The victim's driver was injured in the attack. The police are searching for the gunmen who fled the crime scene on board a motorcycle.
An American diplomat who's been charged with sex crimes in the United States is ordered arrested by a Philippine court for allegedly having sex with an underage Filipina. Dean Edward Chavez is accused of illicit sexual activity with a 16-year-old girl. The crime allegedly happened while Chavez was serving at the U.S. Embassy in Manila between 2020 to 2021. The court recommended bail of 200,000 pesos. Chavez was indicted in the U.S. for sexual misconduct and possession of child pornography.
China criticizes what it calls politicization of efforts of the U.S. in tracing the origin of the coronavirus. As this report tells us, Beijing wants a tit-for-tat approach, demanding an investigation on American labs.
China on Wednesday pushed back against U.S. efforts to trace the origin of the coronavirus ahead of the release of a U.S. intelligence report intended to resolve various theories on how the virus emerged. It includes a once-dismissed theory about a Chinese lab leak. Although U.S. officials do not expect the review to lead to firm conclusions. That's after they said China hampered international investigations on the ground in Wuhan this year, where infections first emerged in late 2019. In response to the upcoming report, Chinese Foreign Ministry's Director General of Arms Control, Fu Kong, suggested tit-for-tat investigations into American labs.
We do not see the need at this stage to continue this lab leak hypothesis. But that is only our wish. and we can accept this any follow-up on this hypothesis if the U.S., on the basis of reciprocity, agrees that they are going to accept similar visits.
Beijing has ridiculed the theory that COVID-19 escaped from a lab in Wuhan. Instead, China suggested without public evidence that the virus slipped out of a lab at a U.S. Army base in Maryland. Chinese diplomats this week once again called upon the World Health Organization to investigate. U.S. President Joe Biden was briefed on the classified report earlier this week, according to White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki on Wednesday. Psaki added the Intelligence Bureau is, quote, working expeditiously to prepare an unclassified version for the public, but she did not provide a timeline.
Hundreds of Greek healthcare workers marched through Athens to protest the government's new policy of mandatory vaccinations for those working in the medical sector. Health workers who have not had at least one shot of the vaccine by September 1st would be suspended from their jobs indefinitely. Other new measures include ending free testing for the unvaccinated to encourage them to get jabbed. Public hospital doctors and nurses worry these are punitive measures that will only make their jobs harder. The unvaccinated make up an estimated 10% of hospital and emergency care workers. Authorities say at least 1 million more people need to be fully inoculated to build adequate immunity through the population. The measures come as Greece hits a new daily record of 4,600 new confirmed cases Tuesday. The Rotary Club of the Philippines will begin providing free COVID-19 testing to tricycle and jeepney drivers in San Juan next week. For more on the program, we are joined by Josh Santos, the Assistant Regional Public Image Coordinator of Rotary Club Philippines. Good morning, Josh. Thank you for joining us.
Hi, good morning, Nikki.
All right. So first off, how soon will you be starting this free testing program? And how exactly will you be going about this? Where will this happen? Where will you be sourcing the test kits as well as the medical staff?
So good morning, everyone. The project will be on Monday, and it is a tie-up project with our Rotaract Club and, of course, the Rotary Club of San Juan del Monte as the main proponent. It is also tied up with the local government unit of San Juan City. So our club is the one who is providing for the testing. And then at the end of the project, all the drivers will be able to get a vegetable pack. While after the testing, or if need be, the driver if the drivers needed to go to isolation, the city health of the LGU will be there to get them or to assess them. For those who will go with a negative result, they can go to the vaccination site right after.
Right, and of the test kits, the medical staff. Where will we be sourcing these?
We got a team of nurses from the Rotary to provide the testing, the antigen testing. Yeah,
that's good to know. And Josh, could you tell us why were jeepney drivers and tricycle drivers the first people you thought of for this initiative? How will you get them to avail of the free testing?
Yeah. Actually, there are a lot of sectors that that we can help at this moment. But at this point, we thought of a group of individuals who are more exposed to different people. So, you know, there are the jeepney drivers and the tricycle drivers meet different people, at least 5 to 10 people a day, individuals a day. So I think that's the first. That's why we picked them as that sector, but eventually we will try to look for other sectors we can help. We coordinated with TODA and HODA, the associations of the drivers, so it's going to be more efficient when we're doing it, and we have a list of beneficiaries.
And in which specific areas will this initiative be done in? Are you also in coordination with all their local government in these areas?
Well, to start with, we are doing it in San Juan City. But eventually, we're hoping that we will be able to do this outside of San Juan, inside the jurisdiction of District 3800, which is Camanava, Marikina, Rizal, Pasig, and Mandaluyong. But San Juan will be first. And with that, I'd like to really thank Mayor Francis Zamora for really tying up with us and making this happen.
Since you're starting this in San Juan, are you also looking to expand this initiative to the country? And if yes, do you plan to coordinate as well with the national government? We know Rotary Club International has also been asking other countries to help fight against COVID-19. But how are these efforts going?
Actually, the Rotary International has a, well, if I can say mandate, or is encouraging all the Rotary clubs in the whole world to have a COVID project. And since we have the polio eradication project, it serves as a blueprint in vaccination. And I think as Rotarians, we know how to do it. And yes, we're hoping that this can be expanded in the whole country. And you know, it can be replicated in by any other city, by any other Rotary Club, by any other district.
Mm-hmm. And apart from free COVID testing, we know you also have several COVID-19 related efforts also being carried out, as you said. Could you share with us some of them?
Well, since the onset of the pandemic, we have been doing different COVID efforts. You know, if there is someone in need, there will be a Rotarian there. So since last year, we've launched the Magsasaka outlet, the Rotary Magsasaka outlet, wherein, if you remember, Nikki, we had problems with the produce of our farmers, and it's not being sold or being bought by people. And that at the same time, here in Metro Manila, there are individuals who do not have food to put on the table. So what we did was we purchased it in a fair price, with a fair price from the farmers, and then donated and gave it to different individuals. I think we served around 2,000 families last year. We also created the first Rotary Oasis Center. So it was a safe haven or a safe space for our frontliners in Quirino Memorial Medical Center. So it was with the Office of the Vice President. We wanted to do that because, if you remember, there were incidents that a frontliner cannot go home, or they are scared to go home. So at least it's a safe haven. It's not just a dorm. It's actually they have a garden complete with, you know, it's a space that they can distress as well. So, and then we provided different sanitizing stations in all the barangays of San Juan City. And we even went out of San Juan City and went to different cities or areas in our district. So,
And yeah. You're also helping provide PPEs for hospitals.
Yes. Actually, the PPEs, thank you for that. The PPEs we provided to 12 hospitals, and it was actually through our global grant from the Rotary International when we were able to do that. So if you remember, there were a shortage of PPEs and at that time. So at that time, we wanted to make sure to solve that, or to give solution to that problem and to help our frontliners as well. So as you see, in Rotary, we really want to find that solution. And even if the problem, small or big, we hope to provide it. We believe that we can end this pandemic through working with each other. So
correct. And Josh, since you said that, no, you're also tapping Rotaract, right? Your youth arm. How can the youth, as well as the general public, help you in your efforts? Do you accept volunteers, donations, and the like?
Yes. We in Rotary, we have this campaign called Elevate Rotaract. So it's actually empowering the youth, empowering our Rotaract. And at this point, our Rotaract Club, the Rotaract Club of San Juan del Monte Premier, has been actively doing campaigns online since, you know, the youth are really good in social media and if that is their core competence. So we understand that there are still individuals who are having a hard time understanding why you need to be vaccinated, why you need to take this safety precaution. So our Rotaract has been doing that. And on Monday, they will be there helping us distribute our vegetable packs. Yes, we are open to volunteers, partners, and our organization would love that. With this project, this is our shot. This is our shot to be together. This is our shot to come together and make things happen. And we cannot do this alone. So it's better to be able to be there for each other, for one another, for the whole country and the world.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us. Josh Santos of the Rotary Club Philippines. You stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you, Nikki. Have a great day.
Meanwhile, in sports, boxer-turned-senator Manny Pacquiao to be honored by the World Boxing Association as a champion for life. WBA President Gilberto Mendoza met with Pac-Man hours before his fight with Yordanis Ugas to tell him about his new belt, regardless of the outcome of the match. Mendoza was also apologetic about taking the welterweight title from Pacquiao when he was dubbed champion in recess in January. The WBA president will be going to Manila in September to hand the new title to Pacquiao, who is the only 8th division world champion in boxing history.
Gaza City finds a way to bring the cinema to the youth, with movie houses there having been closed for years. The so-called cinema bus recently took to the roads in Gaza. It has a capacity of over 60 people and can screen films to 500 people via an outdoor display. It was the first time for many young Palestinians to go to the movies after political tensions forced cinemas in the city to shut down from 1996. The initiative, funded by the European Union, offers a selection of films meant to promote the values of peace and on violence. And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navalio. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.
Time when we are gripped by fear, we are inspired by your courage. At a time when we are in dire need of hope, we look up to your sense of duty and compassion.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
the greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.